Maluko! Brilliantly taken! This is your heart.
Can you feel it? And she absolutely buried that! Pumps through
your veins. Tony Duggan! Oh, she took that so well! That's a great effort. Oh, special goal.
Welcome to a Wembley Stadium buzzing with anticipation on a historic day. In a little under 15 minutes' time, England's women will face an old rival they've yet to beat, Germany. And they'll have a little bit of added help, with up to 55,000 fans roaring them on in the most attended England women's match ever staged in this country. It's getting big.
It's about creating our own history, and we want to make sure that this is a game that people remember for a long time.
It's every girl's dream to play at Wembley. Is there really any England v Germany friendly games? I don't think so.
Singing the national anthem will be a very proud moment.
We're now a team of 55,011.
This occasion is going to be really special.
Hopefully the crowd can give us that impetus to really produce a performance.
Well, what a moment for manager and players alike. England have never beaten Germany in 19 attempts. But if they're going to do it, well, they may as well do it at Wembley Stadium, for goodness sake. Joining me this afternoon are a couple of players with 129 caps between them. And they are English, which means, I'm afraid to say, they have had a fair amount of heartache against the Germans, haven't you? Ellen White and Katie Chapman. It's pouring down with rain today, so we didn't want to become the dollies with the brollies outside. We're hiding a little bit up here in the gantry. But Ellen, you know what it's like to play on this pitch for Team GB in the Olympics against Brazil. You won that day. What's it like?
It's unbelievable to know that the crowd is behind you, 70,000 fans. Behind us, 55 potentially today. It's an unbelievable feeling, and hopefully the players can really feed off the crowd and put in a good, big performance.
Katie, you played a lot for England, out of the picture currently at the moment, but do you fancy this?
I fancy this. These are the games you play for. You want to be playing these teams, you want to be playing Germany. It's a big test. Yeah. Great for the game.
Well, let's have a look at the team that Mark Sampson has chosen today to face Germany, hopefully beat them for the first time in 20 attempts from their point of view. What are your thoughts on the lineup?
It's extremely attacking. The likes of Enia Luko, Tony Duggan, the speed. There's a lot of strength within the whole squad, but they're going for it. They're really got the potential, a lot of goals in this squad today.
Okay, so not long until kickoff. It's important the occasion doesn't adversely affect the players, of course. But what about the manager? Mark Sampson's been talking to Tina Dehealy.
Mark, this is a big test for England against tough opposition. What are your expectations?
Just for the team to do their best. You know, that's all we can ever ask of them. And of course, it's a huge test against, you know, with the best team in the world at the moment. But you know, the players are excited by the challenge and they want to go out there, play our way. And all we can do is go eye to eye and see where we're at. And you know, the players are ready for that, and we're really excited by it.
This is a special occasion for the team to be playing at Wembley in front of a sellout crowd. How significant is this for the women's game?
Yeah, it's great, isn't it? Just to hear that, the fact that we're playing at Wembley and we've sold 55,000 tickets makes it a big occasion for the women's game. And, you know, we're very proud of the fact that we managed to attract this many supporters, and we're hugely thankful for every supporter who will be in the ground today supporting the team, and everyone back home will be watching and supporting from the sofas. But, you know, we hope we can put on a good show and hopefully we can get a good result, which will encourage people to come back. But I think people will really respect the fact that this team will epitomise some really strong human values of honesty, hard work, and that's, I'm sure, what the players will bring to the game today.
And on such a huge occasion, how are you feeling? Any nerves?
Excited, really excited. You know, for me to test myself against a great opponent in Sylvia is an exciting challenge for me, but also excited to see this team play. They've trained great, they've got a real hungry mentality about them, and they're all looking forward to kickoff now. So for me, it's about let's get the game on and let's see how this team do.
And finally, a quick word on Karen Carney, only 27 and about to make her 100th appearance for England.
She's only 27? God, seems like she's been around for a long, long time. No, Karen is a fantastic footballer, obviously. I've been quoted on record to say I think she's one of the best in the world in that position. And more importantly for Karen, she's a very humble and honest person. And you know, when she was recognised this morning in a team meeting, the reaction and reception she got from the players, I thought spoke volumes the type of player she is. And I really hope she enjoys today and the crowd give her a real good round of applause when she gets presented with that 100th cap. But most importantly for Karen, she'll want to play well and help this team win.
Thank you, Mark. Best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Yes, Karen Carney, she's still only young, but she has been around a long time. We remember her bursting onto the scene at Euro 2005. She scored, of course, against Finland as a 17-year-old. But what has she brought, Katie Chapman, in the last decade or so to England?
She's a great player for England. I mean, she's been there. She's a quick, tricky player. Gives her everything in every game. And she scored some really crucial goals as well for England, which has been great. And I can't believe she's getting 100 caps today. Where has that time gone? It seems to have flown. And she's one of the experienced teams now as well for England out there. So she's going to be crucial today in this big test against Germany.
Yeah, Katie, you know all about playing Germany. I remember watching you actually at Selhurst Park when you lost to a Rachel Unit own goal that day. But not a great record, Ellen, against them. 17 defeats, 2 draws. I remember Katie being outstanding against them in the 0-0 draw of the World Cup, but why is it that England haven't beaten them?
Katie's pretty average that game, I'd say. But I don't know. I think they're such an amazing team, Germany. They win when it matters. They've got that mentality, their physicality. But hopefully, this massive stage for England today, we could put on a great performance and completely just write off all those losses and hopefully get that win under our belt to be amazing.
Mentality, physicality, is that all? They've got it in body and mind, but what's wrong with them? That's the trouble, isn't it? Well, what about today? They're missing 5 players, their goalkeeper is a regular, she's not made it over from Australia today, but they've still got plenty of talent.
Yeah, definitely. They've got a team of talent. I think they produce very good players as well in Germany. And against Germany, it's always a tough game. I think we need to go out there and play our game. And he has gone very attacking-minded today. And I think hopefully that pays off for us. I mean, as long as we remember our defensive duties.
Yeah, Sasic up front, by the way. If you're wondering who that is, it's actually Celia Dimbabi. She's married a footballer, Croatian footballer. So she is Sasic, and she's one of the many talented players. Who stands out for you?
I think you just said Sasic, Pop. She's got an amazing amount of goals for a midfielder. I think they've got such a good squad, to be honest, with those 5 missing. So hopefully we can counteract that and put in a big performance.
So it's time to get a decent barometer now of just how far England have come under Mark Sampson. England against Germany in the company of the last player to score in a home international against them, Sue Smith. But first of all, it's Jonathan Pearce.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Good afternoon, everyone. A day of great pride in what has been achieved and what can be achieved by England women's football. A wonderful day in the history of the sport in England. The first official England international at Wembley. The first ever at the new Wembley. Germany, the greatest side in the history of the women's game in Europe, the visitors. What a splendid occasion it is for Karen Carney. She will lead the team out. The leading player there with her niece to earn her 100th cap. She scored in the 2009 Euro final defeat against the Germans. She has 5 goals in her last 3 internationals. Another today with Capital in front of us, you've heard. A record crowd for an official home England women's international. They played in front of 70-odd thousand here as Great Britain. Most of these England girls in the Olympics of London 2012. Steffel scored that day. The German anthem will be the first to be played. It's a terrific day, isn't it, Sue, for England's football?
Oh, absolutely terrific. And I think any, you know, person that's been involved with women's football, this is what we wanted to happen. You know, the fact that we're playing at Wembley against Germany in front of 55,000 people, absolutely fantastic for the game.
Well, the weather is grisly. Nothing will diminish the significance of the day, though, or the pride felt by those England players, and especially Karen Carney. Scored on a W against Italy as a teenager, scored that summer in the European Championships, as Jackie was saying. Marvellous day for her, and a terrific season at club level. She was the top scorer in the Super League. And had she not had a penalty saved on the last day, then they might have won the title. Well, that's a bit rotten of me to spoil her big day. And out comes her golden cap for 100 caps.
And it's so well deserved. It must be a really emotional occasion for Karen Carney, because she's played, she seems to have played for so many years. And like they mentioned earlier, she's actually only 27 years old. So to have 100 caps at that age, there's still many more to come. But fantastic player. And I'm sure she'll show today just what she can do. And hopefully she can enjoy this occasion as well.
6 goals in qualifying for the World Cup final. She got everything off and underway, really, in September of last year with a hat-trick at home to Belarus. Hat-tricks became the order of the day, really, for England in this campaign. They scored so very many. between these two sides. 114 goals in qualification. They conceded just five. 20 years ago, England were playing Germany in front of 2,000 fans in a World Cup qualifier. Here we are at Wembley for the national anthems. World champions. They've won 8 of the 11 European championships, including the last 6 in a row. Alexander Burke will sing the English national anthem. Sung the feeling by Alexandra Burke. This is the Breast Cancer Care International. She lost her aunt to the disease. She's also a Breast Cancer Care ambassador, and all the players will be wearing the pink ribbons today. So let's have a look at the lineups. Mark Sampson has reverted to his mainstay defence, Steph Horton and Karen Bardsley, and the fullbacks Alex Scott and Demi Stokes missed the final qualifier in Montenegro. The front six are unchanged. They'll press high, they'll press quickly. Luko, top scorer in the entire World Cup qualifying campaign with 13. Duggan scored 11. Sanderson's just moved back to Arsenal after a couple of seasons in the US. She could be a star next summer in Canada. 6 of that side played against Germany in the 2009 European Championship final. 4 German survivors, Behringer, Kran, Lauder, Sasic was in that squad as well. The main danger is Sasic. She scored 53 in 98 internationals, 9 in this World Cup qualification, and she's the Bundesliga top scorer again this season. Short plays in goal with the veteran Nadine Angerer staying in Brisbane for club duty, and it's the first international this season for the goalkeeper. She plays with Wolfsburg, the European and Bundesliga champion. So does Gersling, who's been out injured of late. A couple of surprises. No Anja Mittag, who scored 15 in her last 15 German games. And no Jennifer Malachan, something of a German Wunderkind. We thought she would play. Now, Football Remembers is an FA initiative. You see the players of both sides coming together for a photograph, and you'll see Premier League players and Championship players, players all around the land doing this in December. It's part of an initiative between the FA, the Premier League and the Football League coming together to remember the game in no man's land 100 years ago this year in the First World War. It is a women's international, but I have to pay tribute here to Edwin Beverton of Club England on the men's side mainly, because he's really pushed for this, along with Kelly Simmons, the director of the national game. And there will be, I gather, future England women's internationals at Wembley, which is a huge boost for the sport. There's the referee, Esther Strausli of Switzerland. England's women's international at Wembley has to be really good, sir.
Oh, it has to be, and I think this is exactly what the ladies have wanted for years. Like you mentioned, a lot of people have worked behind the scenes to get this game here, so if we can be successful, we can put on a good show. It means that people will come back and watch, so it's a massive occasion for them, and I'm sure that they, you know, that that's what they'll be looking for. They'll be looking for a good result, but also a good performance.
England up to seventh in the world, Germany second behind the USA. 1.7 million women and girls now play the game in England. The FA launched a big plan last year called Game Changer. Since October 2013, nearly 21,000 more girls and women have been brought into the English game. They expect 40,000 by next August. There are many changes afoot, and this is part of those changes.
Definitely, and this just gives, you know, those young girls that opportunity to watch their role models, so they, you know, they can come to the game here, they can watch it on TV, and they can see that they can actually now make a career out of women's football, which has never been the case before. So this is definitely a monumental occasion, an occasion that every female football fan and player have been hoping for years.
And in terms of the game, England have it all to do. They may have breezed through qualifying, but goodness me, this is a different task.
Yeah, this is a massive test for the girls, and they know that. And I think, you know, you look at the German team, yes, they've got five players missing. They've got their Angerer, who's their usual keeper, isn't starting today. But they've still got a fantastic squad out there, and a squad that's very attacking, very commanding, and a team that can score goals. So England need to make it a good start. They need to try and get on the ball, and they need to pressurise really high up the pitch, which I think they'll do.
77 international goals between that pair there. Alexander Popp from the Wolfsburg club and Celia Sasic from Frankfurt. Third in the Bundesliga at the moment. Through to the next round of the German Cup, they'll play Bayern. Who top the table. It's a bright start by England, all in white, on a soggy pitch, kicking from left to right, and the first shot of the day clips the bar from Jordan. From, was it Jordan Nobbs? It might have been Tony Duggan. It was Tony Duggan. He gets there again. What a start! No, it was Jordan Nobbs who had the shot on goal.
Oh, that's a fantastic start, and that's exactly what Mark Sams will have wanted. He'll have said, as soon as the Germans kick off, I want you to get close to them. I want you to pressurise. Jordan Nobbs just finds herself in acres of space and great confidence to actually have a shot from there, and it's unfortunate the keeper actually just gets a touch to just knock it onto the bar. What a start, and that's exactly what they'll have needed.
And she will run all day long, the Arsenal midfielder. Has three for her country and very nearly a fourth. She missed three or four of the games in qualifying with a back injury. The ball isn't travelling quickly on the turf. England's men played here last weekend. Before that, there was the American football match. You can still see one or two shadows in the markings of that day. The rain this week hasn't helped at all. Leupolz for Germany, on the right side of midfield and getting there again. Danger here for England with her run, and a fine save! And the ricochet sent well wide in the end. It was Kramer who got up to slice the rebound. What a bright start to the game, Sue.
It's been end-to-end, you know, first couple of minutes, and I think that's exactly what the Germans can do. They break, their full-backs like to get forward, they're very energetic, and you can see that's where we may get caught, so we need to be aware of that. And it was a fantastic shot and a great save from Karen Bardsley, considering it's the first few minutes of the game.
Just a danger there that Ellie Leupolz will pose down the right-hand side for England. Here's Jordan Nobbs. Scott to Farrah Williams. Most capped English footballer with 132, internationals to her name. And Annie Aluko is offside.
I think Farrah Williams is going to be key today in that, just that holding role. I think she needs to make sure she doesn't drop too deep to get the ball off the defender. She just needs to stay that little bit higher and keep creating that space for Jordan Nobbs and Karen Carney.
Are you surprised that they didn't start Jennifer Marishan?
Really surprised, because I think when we got the squad through, but I think she's a person that they can bring on and obviously change a game, because she's so experienced and she's a prolific goal scorer from that position. She likes to drop in quite deep, and her and Sasic link up ever so well.
Sasic with the touch there, looped away for England by Carney. Carney operating on the left of it, midfield three, Jordan Nobbs on the right, Farrah Williams at the hub of it all, and then Tony Duggan at the front of the diamond. And Sanderson, you make of her return to English club football with Arsenal.
It's great. You want all of these players to be playing in England. You want to be able to watch them week in, week out for WSL. And Leanne Sanderson's not only a great character on and off the field, but she's a very good footballer. And we'll see today, she'll be the one that'll just drop in a little bit deeper, and she'll want to get on the ball, find those little pockets of space and set Eni Aluko up with her pacing behind.
Came on as a sub in that 2009 final when they were well beaten by Germany. And England looked to send Aluko away. Cover was there through Henning. Sent back to play into Paris Saint-Germain. Pulled away for Germany towards Lauder. Sasic. Top to Simon Lauder of Frankfurt again. Hit Alex Scott on the way through. And away for a corner kick. Simon Lauder. Four goals in their qualifying campaign. They, like England, won all 10 of their qualifiers. The back is Kran, wearing 5. She's one of the Paris Saint-Germain players. Taken by Melanie Behringer, Bundesliga leaders Bayern Munich. Just in a tease there for a moment. Sasic, Behringer, Julie Knobs. Behringer, who scored in that 2009 final, will take the corner. A couple of goals against England in a pass, and she's creating one there. The opening goal for Germany, Behringer's corner, headed in by Lauder. 1-0 to Germany.
That's really disappointing from an England perspective. They've done so well at the start of the game, but here, this is an excellent corner in, and she's actually been marked by Alex Scott and Leanne Sanderson, and she just manages, Lauder just manages just to get across the defender, just tries to get across to Alex Scott, and it's a fantastic header into the bottom corner, but England will be really disappointed with that so early on to concede, but Germany is so strong at corners and set pieces.
Twice a European champion, looking to play in another World Cup final, Simon Lauder, and she puts Germany ahead. After 5 minutes, they've never been beaten by England. Let's not forget that. Just a couple of draws for England against Germany, both in 2007, both in China, both 0-0. Headed away, not a great heading clearance away. No pulse. Here's Kran. Behringer. So it's a free kick to Germany, given by the Swiss official.
This is now a mental game, isn't it? This is can England get themselves sorted from that early goal?
Sasic, Behringer. So the pop was drifted out wide to the left hand side. Behringer, just to see if it was now there with the last touch on the goal, or whether indeed it went off an England defender. She was being marked. Last moment, though, she gambled, got ahead. We'll see it again when we can.
Yeah, I think Alex Scott was actually marking her, and I think Leanne Sanderson came across to try and help, whether it took a deflection.
Hammer was involved there, and again, a step forward to Tony Duggan. Leanne Sanderson did have a good position. Lucky with the control, the first touch was a bit heavy. Pushed away by Lauder. It's to be remembered that the German women's Bundesliga is far more advanced than the English Women's Super League is at the moment. We're only in our second year now.
Of course, and you know, like you say, it's very well established, and the players, a lot of the German players do play in the Bundesliga. They play together, so they're used to, you know, they know how each other play, and then they take that into the international setup. We're catching them up though.
Certainly making great inroads now. It's Williams too far forward, and it's Strutt, goalkeeper, goes away to Annika Crowd. 100 caps for her. Another one of major, they finish runners up at the Europeans. Germany have won 10 major competitions. And here comes Alex Scott, starting off as a forward, loves to get forward. She's forced a corner here for England.
Yeah, that's good play from Alex Scott, and both fullbacks, both her and Demi Stokes, will like to get forward at every opportunity. And I think that's where the space will be. I think when Germany like to commit those players forward, there'll be space in behind those fullback areas. So I think that's where they need to try and exploit a little bit more.
Horton's forward from the back, scored on this ground for Team GB against Brazil a couple of summers ago in those mighty Olympics. Williams will take the corner, sending Jordan Nobbs away. There is Jordan Nobbs. Jordan stayed in. Out of the way. That's offside. Do you think this German goal goes to Laura Elton's own goal? Let's have a look. It's an OG.
It's an own goal. It's actually Alex Scott. You couldn't actually tell from the first pictures because it looked like she just directed the header into the bottom corner, but I actually think that is an own goal from Alex Scott, unfortunately for her. Sometimes that puts the goalkeeper off, doesn't it?
Hogan. All the ball away from Lena Gersley. Aluko for England, who has pace, bundles of ability. Had a new viewers today to England's women football, but you have heard me say in the past, Annie Aluko made an appearance in the European Championship finals 1 year, having taken a school exam in history that morning. Now, what will the history books say in a couple of moments? Are Germany about to score their second? Sasic took it one step further to the left and still scores. 2-0 to Germany. In the opening 12 minutes, she was allowed to carry a long, long way, and England simply didn't get close enough to her.
They didn't at all. It was a miscommunication there between Farrah Williams and Steph Horton, and Sasic was just on it quickly, and you could just see that the England players, Alex Scott's trying to get back, Lucy Bronze just couldn't get over quick enough, and Karen Barnsley tried to make herself as big as she possibly could. But that is a world-class, prolific striker that can just, she sees the space, she drives, and she's only got one thing on her mind, and that's to put the ball in the back of the net, and that's exactly what she did. Again, really disappointed from an England perspective. They now need to sort themselves out, they need to get back into the game.
And they're having a team talk. Williams there, the most experienced of them all, trying to get them going again. This has been a really poor opening by England. It's a steep learning curve whenever you play against Germany. Let's not forget England's qualifiers, all of them victories were against the likes of Belarus, Turkey, Wales gave them a couple of hard games. Montenegro well beaten in the two games they played. Ukraine, no real opposition in there. They played Sweden earlier this season in a bid to try and get the players against the sort of quality they'll be meeting next summer in Canada. They won that game 4-0. Germany right now, probably the best of anyone.
Yeah, definitely. I think they're ranked second in the world, and you can see why they are. You know, that was just a typical goal from a German perspective, and I think this is now where the England girls, like you say, they got together in a huddle. They were obviously talking about what they needed to do. You need to remember what your game plan is, and you need to not try and change things. You need to carry on how it is, and you know, if anything needs to be changed, then Mark Sampson will do that. He'll pass the message on somehow.
Well, they've got a hard team to beat and a wonderful coach to try and outmanoeuvre in Silke Knight. She herself played for Germany over 100 times. And to the first German manager, men or women's teams, to have won the World Cup for the first attempt. The highest percentage of wins for any of the German coaches in their history.
She's a very well-respected manager in Germany. Obviously started off as a player and won lots of caps for Germany that way, and now she's continuing as a fantastic manager.
Scored their first ever World Cup finals goal against Nigeria, it was, in 1991. We've got a free kick here. It'll be taken by Behringer. Gets it back again. Sanderson was back defending. And okay against Pock. Comes Karen Barzi, born in California. Finally though, from the Stockport area. It's Horton. Out towards Lucy Bronze. She was loath to come across quickly and close on the goal scorer Sasek's that second goal, because she was aware there was someone running through her channel. She couldn't leave her. But England simply can't get going.
They can't, and when we looked at England's lineup, we've seen that they had a very attacking formation. They had a very attacking, all the players that play like to get forward, and that's the only issue when you're playing against Germany. You need maybe a few of those defensive type players, like the likes of Katie Chapman, you know, who's in the studio, that will get a foot in, and I think that's maybe what they need to start doing at this moment in time, get a little bit closer to the Germans.
Here's Demi Stokes, bright run from her, really strong run, adventurous, energy sapping conditions today. It's a good run by the left back, plays at college in Florida. Come in by Mark Sampson this year, she had a good year in England for Aluko. They simply can't get their passing together, which has been a feature of their qualifying campaign. They've scored 12 goals in the first 20 minutes of their qualifying campaign. They've scored 30 in the first half. Most of those goals have come from crisp passing movements. They simply can't get that going.
Yeah, and you wonder, is that nerves or is it the fact that Germany is stopping them from doing that?
Sasek held it up. Not the first time England have played here. I remember an exhibition game against Scotland ahead of the 1990 Men's FA Cup final on this ground. And it's the first official international at the new Wembley. There's German up for a third.
I think Marianne Spacey, the assistant manager, actually played in that
she
as well.
She did, yeah. The career she had, the assistant manager. Scott with a throw. Sanderson for Luke, that's small like in England. Sanderson's in the middle, Carney's on the far side. It's a free kick. Almost looks as if Germany got an extra play.
Yeah, there was a nice, neat play between Leanne Sanderson and Eniola Luco, and they link up very well. They're good friends off the field, and you can see when they combine and they do it in one and two touch, that's how you're going to get around the German defence. But you can't take too many touches, because there's one player will come of the Germans, then the second player and the third player, and in the end, they'll just crowd you out. So it's got to be quick movement.
Certainly be one of the favourites for the seventh FIFA Women's FA World Cup next summer. Germany, England on the attack now though. And that's a corner. Good work by Karen Carney down that left-hand side.
Very good work by Karen Carney. You can see she's seen her first touch just was a little bit ahead of her. That was Kemé, and then Karen Carney just drives at the players, but you can just see the strength of the German players there, but manages to win England the corner.
Still down from the challenge. Referee saw nothing wrong in it.
I think it was just a good, strong challenge. I think she must have just twisted it as she went down.
Tavia Kemmer down. three starts in the World Cup qualifying campaign. She plays for the Turin Potsdam club. Very strong in recent years, that club. She's never lost an international. It's her ninth game for her country. She came through the 2010 under-20 World Cup winning side. A lot of the players in the German side have come through those junior international ranks, going back to the 2004 under-20 World Cup winners. They've built over a period of 10 years or so.
And I think that's what the Germans do so well. They have a system that they stick through from right the way from, you know, when they first get into the German setup, and they know how to play. So when they reach the senior squad, they're already established in how to play that position.
It is a German FA model. It took the German FA a long time to accept women's football. I'll tell you about that in a minute. It's an interesting story in that. But anyway, here's Barra Williams with the corner for England. And the referee unhappy with the boots. Although I think they're all wearing pink laces to show the... they're supposed to anyway, show their support for the Breast Cancer Care charity. Lots of fundraising activity in and around the stadium. There's a girls under 16 football tournament been played in the last few days. Clubs from all around the country outside on the 3G pitches. On to the corner, played in low and half bronches forward. And he's back on. 2 minutes gone, 2-0 down. What is that all about? Stokes with the throw. Look at a cut. They're applying something to her knees over there, Sue. As play goes on, she might have had blood dribbling from her knee wound. Oh yeah, it's been bandaged, there you are.
Yeah, it was really hard to tell. We thought it was her boots or it was something to do with the shin pads, but yeah, that makes sense now.
Oh, Terry Dutcher ruling. That's what brought it in. Terry had a bad head cut that time, and from then on, no blood allowed. Here's England on the counter. Sanderson to the left-hand side, if they can play in here. They have done. Aluko's in the middle, being joined by Duggan. She checked back, there's a chance gone. Germany have now got 5-6 back. In comes across in the end, but England let the German defenders set themselves, and the chance from then on in was always going to be difficult to create.
Again, it was a good break, and you can see that we can get behind the German defence, and you can just see Toby Duggan just plays it through to Leanne Sanderson. If Leanne Sanderson was left-footed, she probably could have whipped that in first time to Eni Aluko, but the chance had gone when she came back on a favoured right foot, and like you say, there was two or three Germans around her stopping her from playing the ball across.
First German goal, by the way, earned well by Anne Scotchman, it's Sasic. Which is a shot there from Pop. It's the first European to score against England on English soil since Lara Vinnesdottir of Iceland in 2009. England's defence has been dominant at home in recent years, but not today. Watching the midway mark in the first half. Settled now, Sue, but you have to be fair and say that he'll know that. Mark Sampson will know that Germany have taken the foot off the gas pedal a little bit in the last 5 or 6 minutes. Here they come again. They've gone in the heart of the midfield. Melanie Behringer, wearing 7. To Kramer. To Lauda. Goes for the return, and Scott is there with her. She's won 9 leagues and 9 cups in her time. Plus the UEFA at Arsenal. The 7th tournament in this hour. Pretty clever.
Yeah, she has been. I think she'll have a work cut out this afternoon because of the Germans like to attack down this left-hand side and, like I say, include the full-backs as well.
Over there towards Selena Gersling, who got the touch. And it's Kemmer. Pressurised by Sanderson, who has taken a position to pressurise Kemmer throughout this game so far. And then for Aluko, that ball skid off the turf and away. Just wonder, Sue, German players are still very much in the thick of Bundesliga action. Are players have stopped now. They were together for two or three weeks at St George's, the FA Centre, but do you think that lack of competitive edge cost them in the first 5 or 6 minutes?
I suppose sometimes it's that match fitness, isn't it? Because you can get together and you can train and you can do all of your fitness to keep those levels high, but your actual match fitness is totally different.
Pop to Sasic. Cover was there from Steph Horton. 9 players in this English side who played against Brazil in the Olympics in front of 70,500. That was a wonderful day. Great Britain aside. Two of these English players have stepped on the turf before. We're here to parade the under-19 European trophy. When England were playing Belarus, Capello's reign, I remember that night. Lucy Fonch is part of that one. Here's Horton.
Lucy Bronze has done so well because I know she's struggled with injuries. She's had a bad ACL injury that, you know, I think she was out for about 2 years, and the fact now she's playing full-time, obviously, for Liverpool, and now she's gone to Manchester City, and she's a regular in the England team.
Carney, on her 100th appearance. Lovely piece of skill, that. Unlucky not to force at least a corner. That's what she's capable of.
Yeah, that was a cheeky nutmeg, wasn't it? You know, she could see the player coming in, and that was nice. But then again, you see the Germans, that they're back defending. There's always one or two players helping out.
Good with that, the England goalkeeper, Karen Bardsley. Slotted it away to Scott, who had a better option there, but it's come to Enioloko anyway. Mara Williams is there, but she's marked. Interesting that Germany have put Pop now there, right on the shoulder of Farrah Williams, to stop England playing out through their most capped player. Pop swings it away, lovely ball out towards Lurpots. And Gersling. And here's Behringer, who's been very strong, but it wasn't a good pass. And Farrah Williams.
Yeah, I think that's been discussed beforehand, that Farrah Williams will sit in that gap and she will make things happen and, you know, get on her and stop her playing. And you can see if Pop doesn't drop in, Sasic is in there. So they're trying to stop the, I suppose, the start of England's play.
Sanderson battling for it. Gersley. Demi Stokes, Pop, Sasic. Behringer. By Bardsley. It's either a persistent drumbeat going around Wembley, or it's another Sunday afternoon in my head. So I've had a few drumbeats in my head occasionally on a Sunday, I can tell you.
That is definitely a drumbeat, I can hear as well. The atmosphere is fantastic, and you can see when the England girls actually get forward and create something, it just goes up an extra pitch, doesn't it? They're really getting behind the team.
Up towards Pop, beaten in the air by Bronze. Just to see Karen Carney back covering just in front of her centre backs there, got the second header.
That's my only concern, that we're actually getting deeper and deeper.
Pitch is cutting up. Spencer Lepo official beforehand said it wasn't as bad as they first feared it would be after this week's rain, but it certainly hasn't really recovered from the American football or the England senior international. Squashy in parts.
I think as the game continues as well, it'll continue to break up, and I think maybe that's where they need to start using the whip that little bit more, and because it seems like the wide areas are probably the best bits of grass. But these girls are used to playing on dodgy pitches on a sort of December and January month where, you know, this is probably like a carpet to them.
Will this be the permanent home? For England's women, travelled around the country in the past. So Germany, they played on 87 grounds in Germany. Here comes Gresham Scott. Keeper picks it up. The appeal was it launched back to the goalkeeper deliberately.
It's a good break again from England, and mentioned about getting out wide, I don't think it went in. It was a really tough one. I think if I was Jordan Nobbs, I'd have appealed as well. But I think that the goalkeeper just kept the ball over the line. But it was. No, he's going to show it here now.
No, I don't think so.
I don't think so. Wasn't a goal. A promising break though from England again.
This is promising for Germany. Top. Sasic just got there in time, only just. Let's see the referee on the wrist there. She's got a buzzer, and she'll get a buzz if the ball has gone over the line. There it is. Bearing up. Very experienced, 101 caps. Back to the 2007 World Cup win. And it comes. England didn't look totally at ease. It's whacked away by Sanderson. To Kramer. Germany's first international was only in October 1982. Silver Knight was 18 then. National coach has scored on that day. Up in the second half against Switzerland. To be accepted as well by the German FA. It's a good challenge by Bruns. Good tackle.
It was a really well-timed tackle as well. Pop and Sasic just link up so well. We speak about Marijan missing. Fantastic player that's on the bench that can come on. Alexander Pop can just do exactly the same.
We do this quote from the German Football Association in 1955 when they banned women's football from its clubs in Germany. This combative sport is fundamentally foreign to the nature of women. This is not me, this is the German FA saying this. Body and soul would inevitably suffer damage, and display of the body violates etiquette and decency. It was in 1955. 150 international matches were then unofficially played before they lifted the ban.
Wow.
Things have changed.
Thank goodness they have.
How outlandishly antiquated is that quote? And this is the greatest side European women's football has ever seen.
Without a doubt.
It's a free kick. Just a quarter of an hour ago. In the first half. And Bardsley. It's two there. Thompson Williams. That's two. Free kick will be taken by, imagine, Behringer wearing seven, swing it with a right foot. So the merest glance from the three Germans on the far side of the penalty area could pay dividends. England held their line, and it's offside. It won't count. Well, they held their line. It was a risky ploy to play, Sue, but it paid off in the end.
It did pay off, and that takes a lot of guts to do that, because what a ball this was, and she was just offside. You could see Leanne Sanderson just stepped up just at the right moment. Very lucky, but at the same time, very confident to be able to do that, and they all held up. But what a ball that was. That's exactly where we said, as a free kick, that's where you want it to go, don't you? And that's exactly where she put it.
Well, that was the ploy to hold the line. I think it was Leanne Sanderson who went early and then stepped out again. And Lupox got in. Gosh, that's a risky game to play.
You just got to make sure that everybody's on the same page with that. Thankfully, they were in that case for England.
It's 2-0 down, but there's still this sort of feeling of optimism in the crowd. a lot of shrill young cries of support for England. Lots of families here dappled through the gloom of the train and tube disruption. It's Williams. Hobbs couldn't keep it in. Only finished the game. Would have been had her first minute shot not struck the bar off the goalkeeper's fingers.
Just went out of play, you can see there Jordan Nobbs, but we mentioned she's got an engine, she will get up and down the field for 90 minutes, and she struggled with a back injury for Arsenal this season, but when she came back in, Arsenal were a different team. You know, they really missed her presence and her energy.
And when she was missing from England, though the results didn't suffer, I thought the performances suffered a little bit. She missed four games.
Definitely, and you can see when she comes back, that's just what she provides.
And they're getting forward from my back. So no folks. There with her. Well, the little huddle the England players went into at 2-0 down has certainly paid dividends. They've been a lot more solid since then. I said that here from Germany again. Carney tried to find Sanderson. Here's Luca. I haven't seen a lot of her. She's well shackled. Comes now to Tony Duggan. And he mobs up with her, and she's away towards the right-hand side, trying to find Sanderson, and the referee's brought things back to give England the free kick.
That's good play from Tony Duggan. That was an intelligent bit of skill. She went past the defender, and all the defender could do was bring it down. If you can see, she just drives across the defender, and she's going to get some sort of a kick or a pullback, and that's what she's got. She's won her team a free kick, and I think, you know, Tony Duggan, that isn't her usual position in that number 10. She normally plays as an out-and-out striker for Manchester City, so she's probably getting used to that as well today.
Karen Carney, 100 caps for her. Germany vastly expendable, vastly experienced, though. That's the free kick. And the Bronze have got up from the back, claiming the corner. Well there. Lucy Bronze. Let's see, so moments ago, has just joined Manchester City from Liverpool. They won the Continental Cup, Manchester City. That's the equivalent of the League Cup. Arsenal won the FA Cup. In comes Farrah Williams' corner. Liverpool won the League. And he's chipped. Two German centre-backs, Kran and Henning, who play together for PSG, very strong.
Yeah, Kran's played for years for Germany, and she is that strong defender that's really awkward and difficult to get round.
Five members in the squad who won the 2007 World Cup. 12 members of the squad won Euro 2013. Sanderson just went a little bit too early. Ball just dropped short as well. He's popped. He goes across. England. Mark Sanderson to go from Brent Hills. He's now working on the development of England's women's football at a different level. Free kick to England. Some little glimpses of Sylvia Knight, the German manager. She was able, though, to use the work done on the youth development programme by her predecessor, Tina Tuina. Been a work in progress for 20 years, and it shows. Now that Sasic Cramer. England ever got close enough to bearing up. Gersling, good ball, saw Sasic coming in off the wide position. No power behind the shot, but she was left in too much space.
You just can't give Sasic that amount of space because you know exactly what she's going to do, and that's either drive at you or she's going to shoot, and she did that there, and luckily again for England, she just couldn't quite catch hold of it. But here you see she's got time to have a touch, have another touch, look up, and then have a shot before somebody closes her down. So they need to get that little bit tighter to her. And also, I think you mentioned Beringer, that's somebody else. I feel she's picking the ball up in midfield with very few people challenging.
And they've unbeaten on home soil in 18 games, 16 of those won over the last 5 years, but they have it all to do here now.
But I do feel on a positive note that if they do get a goal, especially before half-time, they've showed that they can break the German defence down. It's just having maybe that little bit of luck or that last little bit of clinical passing could create a chance.
Germany won 15 of their last 16 games. France beat them a matter of weeks ago. They've only lost 3 games since the last World Cup finals.
That's impressive. I actually read that France had beat them, but they're another good team and a team that have, you know, probably gone through a bit of a change. They've had, you know, new players come in and old players retire, but they look a force as well.
Aluko chasing down on Henning. Centre-half team at Kram can't keep it in play. Stokes, so 9 of the last 11 games since coming into the side. This looks for Luko. Stretching forward and getting the shot away was Farrah Williams. Decent effort that.
It was a decent effort and it was a good bit of control. This is what Farrah can do. She can get on the ball, she can get a good touch like she done there, because it was a bit of a nothing chance really. The ball was cleared and you can see Farrah Williams straight away. Great touch on the chest, and it's a volley, and unfortunately she just couldn't get hold of it, because I've seen Farrah Williams score those, you know, top corner. Good effort though.
Fourth highest scorer in the history of the England's women's game. Horton looks long, I said, and it's gone away. That's a fantastic pass. What can she do with it? Stretching, quick tip behind.
See what she was trying to do? She was trying to whip it in first time to the far post, but just couldn't get a foot round it. Nice ball from Steph Horton to set that away though.
No, they've done it all and won it all, Germany. They came into this game really excited to be playing at Wembley. They opened up their own World Cup finals 4 years ago, kind of 73,000 against Canada. That was a European record, but virtually all the squad have been saying the same things about coming to Wembley, the privilege of playing at Wembley, the historic importance of Wembley Stadium. The pressure on Henning, she still gets it back to Arnold Schult. Back to that opening minute shot. Jordan Hobbs is taking the throw in. Schult in her first appearance of the season reacted superbly well to anything.
She really did, and I think that, you know, we haven't really spoken much about Angerer, the natural goalkeeper that's played hundreds of times for Germany, and she's won FIFA Player of the Year. You know, she's a fantastic keeper, their captain, and the fact that they've got a new goalkeeper in, you think test her early on. That's exactly what they did, and she managed to pull off a good save.
Up, goes for the Brisbane Roar. And they stayed there at the moment. Make the long trip for 137th day. She's promising for England. Carney. Put the shoulder, went inside for Tony Duggan. And behind her was the present Annika Kahn. A little bit of afters perhaps between the two of them. Stokes, she's got some of them, she's a cup final with them, she was a teenager,
She's done well there. Carney bustling to the dead ball line. She's done very well. England finishing the half well.
Really well. She did excellent there to actually get herself round. But a lovely bit of skill from Debbie Stokes to initially set it up. And that's what Karen Carney can do. She can drive her players. And, you know, you can see the defender's actually holding her arm to try and stop her from getting round. But she's won her team a corner.
Williams will take it. Duggan with the flick on. Nearly came to Bronze, who was arriving late. Hoisted back in, looking for Sanderson. The pressurised Cran. Was underneath it again. Horton the captain. Aluko. Got the pace to get to the dead ball line. But there were three on her straight away, and that's been the story of her game. As soon as England had found any Aluko, there have been three German shirts around her.
The Germans know exactly who the threats are, and any Aluko is a threat with their pace, with their skill. And as soon as she gets the ball, like you say, they're on a straight. Exactly the same as with Farrah Williams. When she gets the ball, they stop her. And they're very intelligent, very technical, tactical players that know these things. They'll have looked, they'll have researched, and they're stopping England.
Horton clears away. Pot. And now to bring it down and play it out wide. Danger here for England. Sasic! 3-0. England were lopsided. Germany found the player over. Sasic lost the marker. Virtually a free header. She doesn't miss them. She has two. Germany have three. And England have a huge job as we're in stoppage time at the end of the first half.
Jonathan, we've just been speaking about how well England have finished the half. You know, they've been creating chances. Germany need one chance and they score it. They're so clinical, they're so direct. And you can see here, just one and two touch passing. Demi Stokes was outnumbered there at the back post. But Sasic just in between Steph Horton and Alex Scott. Nobody's picking her up. And it's a free header, just directs it. Karen Barnsley couldn't do anything about that, the goalkeeper.
England on their big day, playing at the new Wembley for the first time. It's all gone wrong for them. A minute of stoppage time coming to an end. And the end of a grisly first half in rotten weather. Terrific support, enthusiastic support. There will be pride in the achievement, but not in the first half defending. 1-0 down early on to an own goal. Six of Pitt's got two for Sasic. One after 12. A header in stoppage time. No chance for Karen Barton in the goal. And at half time here at Wembley Stadium, it's England 0, Germany 3.
Okay, so fair to say it's not going to plan for England at a very wet Wembley Stadium. It was a red-hot start, though, for the Three Lions. But since then, it's been all Germany. Mark Sampson's half-time team talk will be very interesting. Needs to have a real effect to get England going at the start of the second half. Katie Chapman and Ellen White with me. What did you make of that?
Really well. I mean, obviously to start and hit the crossbar, if we'd have gone in, maybe it would have been a different story. I think towards the end of the first half, I think we put on the pressure, but it just shows how good they are that they went up the other end and scored after all that pressure.
Is that Germany just being Germany?
I think so. They're very, very clinical. They had three chances, four chances maybe, but scored the three chances. And their mentality, their physicality, they're popping balls in the midfield, and they're scoring the three goals. So we need to be more clinical.
It could have been so different, couldn't it, bearing in mind that England made a blistering start to the game and they had a wonderful chance in the opening minute or so for Tony Duggan.
Yeah, I mean, it would have breeded confidence, obviously, into it. We played some good football. The strike looked straight onto the crossbar. I think if that would have gone in, it would have been a different story. Unfortunately, it hit the crossbar.
It's an unbelievable strike, and if that had gone in, it like Katie said, it would have been a great, great start for England. But unfortunately, it didn't go in.
Yeah, Jordan Nobbs with a strike there. Yeah. So it shows that they had the confidence coming out from the start, but then almost had it sapped away from them when Leupolz almost put Germany in front.
It was a great save by Karen Bardsley, but it was again good play by Germany down the right hand side. Great strength and physicality, but a great save to push the ball just away from Germany, and then the second shot didn't really do anything. But yeah, it was good play by Germany, and it just shows how clinical they can be and how strong they are. And but I think Karen Bartley stood up to that one.
Clinical, physical, mentality, it's all the same words we use match after match, tournament after tournament, isn't it? And Germany taking the lead. It was deemed to be an own goal in the end by Alex Scott from Behringer's corner.
That'd be a massive blow, I mean, for them to be an own goal as well. It's a kick in the teeth. I think where we hit the crossbar, and just to see this, I think it's just the margin. I think she kind of gets away from us, and maybe Alex didn't quite see it as he came across. I think it's an unfortunate own goal. Not much she could have done about that, but it's one of those things.
What should England have done better there?
It's a hard one, really. Germany are running onto the ball, so they're getting that momentum onto the ball, and we're kind of running back trying to defend it. So it's unfortunate, but I think we need to defend it a little bit better.
Celia Dumbarby used to score lots of goals when that was her name. Funnily enough, she's still scoring as Celia Sasic. Phenomenal record for Germany, and adding another two goals at Wembley. Again, what could England have done better here?
I think defending. I think our back line is a bit unsettled. I think we just need to get tighter and to stop their balls going forward. I mean, they look very comfortable on the ball, Germany. I think just a mistake there from Stefan Farrer, a bit of communication. Our back line's really unsettled there. Lucy comes across, Alex tries to recover, but unfortunately, the prolific goal scorer she is, she puts it in.
Obviously, she's running right at the defence, and Lucy Bronze just doesn't know whether to go or not. I think she should have just gone full pelt straight to Sassy. She would have had a harder decision whether to score there, but she was kind of deliberating whether to go or not because she had a defender right behind her. But it's a great finish. You can't say anything. It's a good finish.
What are the reasons, do you think, behind England's back four not looking too settled today? Because they had such an easy run in qualifying. You can't deny that. They weren't really tested by anybody. Do you think that's had an effect today?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's massive. There's a massive gap between the teams they've played, obviously, in the qualifying games. And then to come and play Germany, who are European champions. And it's been tough. Yeah, it is tough to play Germany. And that's what we've got to be. We've got to compete against these countries, the big countries, because that's what it's going to be in the tournament in Canada.
Herself to a couple of goals. Let's have a look at number three, which might just have sapped the life out of England before half time.
Yeah, definitely. I think it was really disappointing, actually. We had a lot of pressure before this goal, and then they went up the other end and scored it. Fantastic cross, but she's in between of Steph Horton and Alex Scott, and I think they'll be very disappointed that she's in between them and managed ahead of the ball. One of them's got to lock onto her, and one of them's got to take that player and actually header it away. But it's a fantastic header again, but someone needs to take the leadership and take that player.
Well, if you could bear it, we'll be talking a little bit more about the first half in a few minutes' time. First of all, though, a couple of matches to bring you up to date on that took place a little bit earlier on today. And in the Barclays Premier League, Crystal Palace beat Liverpool by 3-1. And in the Scottish Premiership, it was Partick Thistle 0, Aberdeen 1. And the best of the action from Selhurst Park and also from the KC Stadium, where Hull facing Tottenham in a 4 o'clock kickoff will feature on Match of the Day 2 this evening. Every year,
55,000 people. Well, my goodness gracious, let me tell you the news. My head's been wet with the midnight dew. Go and tell that midnight rider. Tell the rambler, the gambler, the backbiter. Tell him that God's gonna cut you down.
Before Match of the Day 2, tune into BBC 3 tonight for the thrilling conclusion to the Formula One season. Was Lewis Hamilton or Nico Rosberg the last man standing? All the action from Susie and the team from 7 o'clock this evening. Well, Formula One had a two-way fight for honours going into the last race. The WSL season was even more dramatic, with three teams in with a shot at the title, eventually claimed by Liverpool. It marked the end of a domestic season that's seen further growth in a game that continues to go from strength to strength.
To get an England women's game at Wembley Stadium shows how far the women's game has come, and that in itself is a defining moment.
Really exciting season, lots of exposure in the game, increasing awareness.
And off you go.
The progression has been massive. It makes it a lot easier when you're going and telling people, you know, why shouldn't you go and play and go and have some fun?
England!
After the Olympics, we launched Game Changer, our strategy for women's football. We felt that we could really build on the momentum of the Olympics. We've just appointed a new elite unit whose role is to support and develop the women and girls game.
We've now got a number of full-time staff you know, for the first time in years, who are in a position to really affect change on the ground. And the challenge for Brent and his team is to make sure that, you know, we're moving in the right direction.
We've built the game up from top to bottom. We've had a really great programme this season with the Premier League and the Football League and Sporting, whereby we've got 20,000 new girls playing weekly.
It's brilliant to see that, you know, that people are not afraid to go and play a male-dominated sport.
The quality of the football is fantastic. Probably the most exciting finish a league has ever had, never mind the Women's League. You know, the final day of the WSL is incredible. Three teams could have won.
It is heartbreak for Chelsea and for Birmingham. Congratulations, Liverpool, the Women's Super League champions.
It's great having WSL2 for the first season, so the whole promotion battle for WSL2 and the relegation battle in WSL1 just creates more interest for fans, for people watching on television.
At the moment, it's fantastic, isn't it? You know, people are coming out and watching WSL football, which can only be positive for the game moving forward, but the last thing we want is this to be the pinnacle.
I still think that every single club needs to be training every day as a team, being professional, for it to go to the next level.
One area that we'll really be focusing on next year is trying to get all of the fans that are following England to come more and more to watch the WSL. We've got about 1,000 people coming to the top games now, but obviously want to build on that.
People, if they can't get to the game, can actually watch it and enjoy, you know, the football being shown, and people can then talk about it, newspapers start writing about it. So when you're putting it in front of people's face, you just accept it as the normal.
Having England on the BBC, having the success of the WSL, people can see, you know, young women can see a pathway through. Now, if I'm a young girl in school and I love football, I can think, well, actually, I could come through and be a professional footballer.
We're lagging behind greatly, the likes of America and Germany, and the amount of young girls playing the game. So the more we can get playing, the bigger the pool of potential talent.
The FAs, you know, Continental Roadshow, the fan zones, they're the sorts of initiatives where young players have got the chance to meet, you know, England and WSL players, and it can only inspire young women.
How about Bianca? Shout her name. Good. Now you're free.
I had the idea that I wanted to set up my own coaching company, go around different schools. If you can get to someone before they start thinking I'm a girl and I shouldn't be able to play, then they won't see any reason that they can't play.
Excellent! So we're going to communicate.
Yeah. It's really important that we not only focus on players, but we get more women into coaching. And just putting a new elite unit in at St George's Park. And one of their focuses is about making sure that we've got a pipeline of talented, highly qualified female coaches.
It's to get youngsters involved in becoming, you know, a physio, a referee, a coach, a manager, you know, whatever it is. And there's so many different jobs you can do.
That pathway's there that just wasn't there before, and those opportunities are there. And I think that's inspiring girls and young women to get into the game.
To sit here as a national manager knowing that in many years to come, either myself or the next person who takes this job will have a good pool of players to pick from, you know, puts the game in a good place.
And if you're watching and wondering how you can become involved locally in football, or any other sport for that matter, then head to our Get Inspired page on the BBC website, or you can find them on Twitter at BBC Get Inspired. And for the slightly younger viewers, perhaps such as Katie's boys, maybe my little girl, CBeebies has got just the thing for you.
Hi everyone, it's time to get moving. Squeeze. Now you've got the skill, you can pass it on.
Well, with 129 England caps, you reckon that Rachel Yankee's probably a half-decent coach and a role model for small people, and she'll be passing on her considerable knowledge in Footy Pups, which starts sometime in the new year. That's a brand new series teaching children aged 3 to 6 some basic sports skills. Never know, they might even end up playing here one day. Maybe they'll end up playing at the World Cup. And speaking of that, we're absolutely delighted to announce that we'll be bringing you every single match from next year's tournament in Canada. England will be there, and so will the BBC. It all kicks off on the 6th of June, and the final live from Vancouver on the 5th of July. So England on the way back out onto the pitch. 3-0 they trail against Germany. Well, when it was 2-0, England did have a series of chances to try to get back into the game, starting with a chance for Jordan Nobbs.
No, I
think if we potentially could have scored this goal, it could have been 2-1, and they went down the other end just after this goal, after this shot, and scored to make it 3-0. But we're all umming and ahhing whether this had gone in, but I think she just held on to it. It was just on the line, so we're all clutching at straws, hoping that it would have gone in. But yeah, a little bit disappointed that didn't go in.
And then Karen Carney with a free kick, and Lucy Bronze, the centre-half, with a header not too far away.
No, not too far away. I think she was under pressure there as well. I think that made it harder, obviously, for Lucy to get good contact on that header. But I believe we got a corner from that, so we put the pressure on from there.
We're slightly clutching at straws, aren't we? We mentioned it earlier about some of the half chances. England haven't really hurt Germany. There's another chance here for Farrah Williams, but do you feel that Germany have ever really felt under threat from England?
Not really, to be honest. I think they feel probably quite comfortable with what happened in the first half. But come the second half, hopefully we'll be a little bit more pressure on. But if Farrah just got a little bit more contact on this, could have potentially been 2-1. But hopefully all guns blazing this half for England.
We talked before the match about what an attacking lineup it was from England. I mean, I was only half joking when I saw Katie earlier and said, we could really do with you in the centre midfield. Would you be up for it?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, these are the games you play for. To be out there at Wembley as well, it's a great occasion. But I think we do need a bit more fight in us, and hopefully start this half as we did the first half, and make it a better one. Make sure we attack and we hopefully can get a goal from that and get ourselves in this game.
Yeah, talking about another player who's not involved, it's Anita Asante. I know she's been mentioned. She'd be fantastic in the centre midfield today.
She'd be unbelievable. I've said she's got Velcro.
OK, well, let's see how England can get back onto it. It's back to Sue Smith and Jonathan Pearce.
Thanks very much. Germany have made three substitutions. Kicking from left to right in this second half, and they brought on the two players we were talking about right at the start of the program. Jennifer Marisan, she's wearing 10. She has scored 73 goals at all levels of German international football. She's a terrific 22-year-old talent. And Anja Mittag, she's 29, been around since March 2004 when she made her debut. She has also come on for Germany. The third substitute, Risa Wensing, has come on, a right back. She's come on for Tabea Kemmer, Behringer and Lofholtz, the other two players who have departed. Well, we were looking forward to seeing Sue Marisan play and Mittag play, but not at 3-0 down England.
No, definitely not. It'd be nice if it was 3-0 up England, but it will be nice to see Marisan, because she's that type of player, you know, that number 10 player that likes to drop in, similar to Leanne Sanderson from an England perspective, who'll get on the ball and she'll make things happen. But that's probably the last thing that the England players wanted to see.
It's a throw in to Germany. If you just joined us, scored nearly 6 minutes, an own goal by Alex Scott. And their major threat through the middle, Celia Sasic, scored 2-1 right at the end of the first half. And England were just feeling their way back into the game. As you saw in those half-time highlights, they had a couple of late chances. There's Mittag, looking for Pop. Also, at the heart of midfield for Lena Gersling, 20. And Scott has it now, chased down by Laudet. England need to do to get right back into the game straight away. They weren't doing in that first half, then, so.
Well, I think it's probably a common thing to say, but they need to get an early goal. They need to score to get that little bit of confidence back. But I think for me, they've got to get tighter in midfield. You know, they've got that diamond formation in there, and I think at times Farrah Williams has been left with two German players, and it's difficult for her to cover the two. So I think Karen Carney and Jordan Nobbs both have to come in a little bit tighter when defending to make it a three, and then leave Tony Duggan as I would say that the number 10 is going to push on. And I think that's something that England will have to do to, I suppose, get themselves back into the game.
There's the prolific German coach, Sylvia Knight, a terrific player in her time. She won league title six times with Siegen. Aluko. Running up in one of them to the middle. Aluko to the touchline. It's a throw to England. Stokes will take it. Jordan Moore. Leicester. Sanderson on the edge of the penalty area. Douglas just floated into a good position, but it's a throw to Germany. England couldn't make good use of it.
We mentioned as well that England are renowned, you know, especially under Mark Sampson. They play some very good, nice, neat passes, and I think we need to get back into that. We've been a little bit sloppy at times in the final third, so if we can get that passing a little bit crisper and a little bit more clinical, I think we'll create more chances. It's easy for us to say, though, isn't it?
Jordan Hobbs leaves the ball for Nick Scott to take the throw. Bronze. Demi Stokes. Tag comes to Peter. Slight misjudgment. Right fullback position for Germany by Lisa Bensing, substitute, only 21. That European 2013 winning squad, which approaches the one game on there. Sounds an early ball, looking for Luca. Created danger. And they had to get it away for a throw in. Can't think it was. Clouted by her own goalkeeper as she came out.
Good play there from Leanne Sanderson. It actually started from Jordan Nobbs. Lovely, she actually won the ball, then headed it forward, and then you can see Leanne Sanderson in the first half, she didn't put that ball in early enough with her left foot. It's on her favoured right foot here. You can see she just whips it in just behind the defenders. That's what a striker wants, and you can see Enya Luko is on it, but she just couldn't get there in time before their goalkeeper came out.
Better though from England. Carney, only a goal kick. Two this afternoon's game. England hadn't conceded a goal at home in six internationals in a 9.25 hours. In 3:45. Sausage. The edge of the penalty area, waiting for Cross to come in. And strong down their left hand side, Germany. Kramer supporting Simon Laudet.
Yeah, their movement's excellent. Laudet will come in field, Kramer will go on the outside, and they just create those 2v1 situations, and it's so difficult for a fullback to mark, and that's where you need, like, say, Jordan Nobbs, Karen Carney to come back and just help out a little bit. They like to get forward, but they have to do the defensive responsibilities as well, which they are doing.
Henning. Best of classes, now it's got the clear away now for England. It's away from Arishan. Took the eye in 2008 at the 17th World Cup. She went silver ball, scored 4 goals. Best player, finished third. She won the European under 17 title the same year. She was top scorer in that. Scored Euro 2013. Winning gold in the semi final, I seem to remember. Away by bronze. Kramer, Potsdam. Both first half forwards. Pull back to a good man. Turbine Potsdam. 7 miles from PSG. Sanderson has been at the Boston Breakers Club in the USA for the last couple of seasons. Arsenal fans will enjoy seeing her next season. The Super League kicks off in the new year again. Two divisions, of course, now. It's made a huge difference to the progress of women's football in England. Free kick here for the foul on Leanne Sanderson.
That was really clever from Leanne Sanderson. I didn't think it was a free kick. I'd like to see it again. But she's got two or three players around her, and you can see she's just trying to get round. Oh, she does actually pull her back, but clever, because she wasn't going anywhere. So she's won herself a free kick, and in quite a dangerous position. You know, if Karen Carney can whip this in, you've got players like Steph Horton, Lucy Bronze, Leanne Sanderson herself, who are good in the air.
They're all in that picture. Instructions coming out from Mark Sampson, the England coach. Karen Carney turned, listened, and now looks efficient defensive formation by the Germans. Should deal with it, and they do. And that's a goal kick. You can see the way they were lining up. There's a degree of naivety there about the England attack, I'm afraid to say. So
I think, you know, you can see that England have tried to do different things with their set pieces. You've seen on a couple of corners they've actually gone quite short, and they've done so. I think they've worked on that because, like you mentioned, Germany is so efficient, so strong in the air. So they've tried to do something that may, I suppose, surprise them a little bit. But in that respect, that was simple defending for the German defence.
Sasic. Substitutes. Benzing made the run too early. That was a terrific end to the Women's Super League, Brennan. You're hearing at half-time, the three clubs could have won the title on the last day. Liverpool beat Bristol 3-0 to leapfrog Chelsea, who lost to Manchester City away. Birmingham were held by Knox 2-2. So Liverpool won the title. Golden was from Chelsea. Birmingham third, Arsenal in the fourth won the cup. Man City in fifth won the Continental Cup. Cricket to England. Success for English clubs in Europe before. Birmingham got to the Champions Cup semi-finals this year. German clubs have dominated European club football for years. Wolfsburg, current European champions. Carney.
It's great that Bristol are actually still in it as well. They're in the quarter-finals, so they're still sort of flying the flag for English football, British football.
Glasgow City.
Yes, they're still in it as well. So it's good to see that we're actually now competing and getting through to the latter stages of the Champions League. And like you mentioned, it just shows how far that women's football has come in this country.
Do you think they need to work on the timing, though, the dates of the Champions Cup setup? Because it's sort of 18 months on from when you qualify, you can get to the finals. The progressive season for the English game is the following year.
Definitely.
Luko. Once again, Josephine Henning has been superb for Germany, was behind her. Looks as if they're going to get a substitute ready. And here's Tony Duggan. Trying to set Jordan Knobs away. And it's Scott Buckley. Knobs helping out, here's Sasic. Said to me at half time you'd like to see coming on for England.
I'd like to see Fran Kirby. I think she's plays in WSL2 for Reading, but she's been outstanding, and she's just come into the setup. But I watched her against Sweden, who are a top nation, and I thought this will show if this girl can play at international football against a top quality opposition. She scored in the player of the match, so that just shows that she can.
There's a free kick for England. It's going to be a yellow card. Tag has been called to the Swiss official, and there's caution.
Okay, good play from Karen Carney driving in field, and you can see Mittag just slides in, and you know you can't do that. She's nowhere near the ball, so
I think they're going to send on Greg Kirby. It seems to be getting ready on the far side. That's why I asked the question.
It's a good job I didn't say someone else.
Luko waits in the middle. Karen Carney's free kick. Two in the German wall. Holmes is up to the back, and she's been a danger at set pieces. Leanne Sanders, she might be the girl to go off for Kirby. This could be her last chance. And with the free kick. Fair away. Jordan Knox. First touch is a little bit heavy. Still pressurised though, and forces the throw England's way. For Gersling. Scott will go forward to take it. Approaching the hour. Sanderson. Scott. Only through. Johnson on the throw. Oh, what the assistant it was, because she's changed her mind. In the end, it's the right decision between referee and assistant. Carney. The space ahead of her. Sanderson tried to set it up for Duggan. And it's got nipped in. Offside. But unfortunate, she came from an offside position. Jordan Nobbs became active, and that's why the flag was raised.
Yeah, that was really unfortunate there, because you can see she is just offside, but she'd just come back into play. And then obviously Alex Scott hadn't seen that, but it's looking promising. You know, they are creating those chances. They're looking a little bit more confident, and maybe Germany have stepped off their gas a little bit, but still looking good.
Sasic allowed to turn. Attack. Then Sink, two substitutes combining there. Here's Gersley. Well, because she's not played this season due to injury for Germany, she's playing for a club. I want to get her to have at least 70 minutes. Good switch of play to Kramer. Gets ahead to it. Here's Carney. Don't risk that. Carney Stokes can get it away.
Yeah, Gosling does an excellent job for Germany. She just sits just in front of the defence, and she just picks the ball up and plays it nice and simple and starts the play for Germany. So she's very valuable for them, and they'll be glad that she's recovered well from her injury.
Farrah Williams. Head out. Here's Pop. Good ball in from a player who was sensational in the 2010 under 20 World Cup. Top scorer and best player. Enthusiastic crowd whose enthusiasm has slightly waned with a 3-0 scoreline and a miserable day rain wise, which is cooling.
I think the band's still playing. And
still playing.
Yeah. Hopefully, you know, I think Frank Kirby, she'll be another player that'll come on and hopefully inject a little bit of excitement and pace into the game to get the crowd going again.
And they've got that replacement bus service to think about back into London tonight instead of the tubes. I was on that last night. 2.5 hours from the Emirates to Wembley. Bit of a record. England make a substitution. And it is Frank Kirby who's going to come off. And bring the goes Ania Luca. Might have been her, might have been Sanderson. I think they've taken either off.
Yeah, I'm quite surprised at taking Ania Luca off, just because of her pace, her threat in behind. Maybe Mark Sanderson's looking at this now. He knows exactly what Ania Luca can do. Now it's to bring Frank Kirby on, a young player that's, you know, give her a chance to test herself against the best defenders in the world, see how she copes.
Player of the year in WSL 2, 29 goals in 22 games in all football for Reading. Not the club since she was 8, she's just become their first professional footballer. Here's Leanne Sanderson, dangerous crossing, thrown away. Steph Horton. Better second half for England, nearly ruined there though by a sloppy crossfield ball. Lucy Bronze was skipping the challenge. Amy Stokes, Carney. Already burrowing away. German throw.
Good play. I think I mentioned earlier, to get round the German defence, you have to play that one and two touch. You can't, if you take too many touches, they're just going to be around you. They surround you and stop you playing. And you can see when they do that, England, they seem to create those little opportunities.
Horton. Wonderful Olympic she had 2 years ago. All the dynamics and ambition. Athleticism expected in a captain by Mark Sanderson.
Steph Horton actually started a trade as a centre midfielder. I played at Leeds with her there, and you know, both footed, cultured right foot, and she's now settled into centre half.
Good run in the qualifying towards the end, five starts in the last six, but she wasn't an automatic starter at the opening stage of the qualification period. Maybe trying to win it back, Gersley. Tag on the edge of the penalty, yes, Sasic in there as well. Shot was the substitute Morosan. Blocked issues again there, Jennifer Morosan.
Good play from the Germans. There's, at times, there's five or six German players attacking there, the English defence, and it's so difficult to cope. When they defend Germany, they defend in a 4-4-2, and it's really, really solid. When they attack, at times, it's a 4-2-4 or even a 4-1-5, and it's so hard to pick those players up.
Stokes. An ambitious that. Mid-tag. Team fishes on, trying to get to the return. Shot of the ball by Karen Carney. Three-year-old Demi Stokes, one of the successes of the qualification period with a throw. She's a natural left back in the early stages of the qualifying period. They kind of put square pegs into round holes there, really. Got away with it because the quality of the opposition was poor in some cases. We have to say this, it may sound harsh, it was pathetic at times, some of the opposition, Sue.
Yeah, it was, and you know, when you're winning games in double figures, it's not good for the players, even when you're playing and scoring lots of goals. It does, yes, it builds your confidence, but when you're playing against teams like this, this is what you want to play in. You know, these are, you want to test yourself against the best players in the world.
Sasic trundles through the middle to see if they can get the ball into her from Simone Laudet. And the Mittag is there with her. She's into the penalty edge, touched away by Kirby. Isn't able to get forward yet for England. Carney. Simonson's away to the right-hand side. There were better options there. England trying to play very ambitious sort of Hollywood balls. And instead, the shorter, simpler, easier option was on.
Yeah, definitely. There was definitely an easier pass there. I think that she was looking for Leanne Sanderson out wide, and it was definitely a Hollywood ball. And I think Frank Kirby just seems to have sat in as the number 10. So Tony Duggan and Leanne Sanderson are now featuring up top together.
So to get something out of the game, England have to score three. Germany have conceded, only lost three games, I should say, in 38 since World Cup 11. Very rarely concede. If England can get one, the crowd will respond. You never know. On the far side. Copper's made the run to the edge of the penalty area. Shielding it away there from Demi Stokes. Looking for Sasic on the hat-trick. Now, what Sasic didn't realise was that Louisa Bensing, the substitute, was coming flying up behind her. Maybe it would have been a better option to leap. There she goes with the blonde ponytail.
That's a great spot. And like you say, she's just looking for a hat-trick, isn't she? You know, so she's going to rise and she's going to try and score that third goal, but maybe she didn't hear the call, but she was stretching for it, so couldn't get that power on the header, where Venting coming in at the back would have been able to.
She had the momentum of the run. Now, as does Frank Kirby, looking for Duggan on the edge of the penalty area. Duggan really pushed on now, since the substitution with Luca going off. Again, a wonderful World Cup qualification period, despite injury. Managed to score 11 goals. The hat-trick's in there for her.
Yeah, and this is in natural position as well. Like I said, she plays as an out-and-out striker for Manchester City, so she's used to this position. So we'll see, hopefully, that she'll get on the ball that little bit more.
Sanderson. Scored a hat-trick at home to Montenegro and away against Montenegro, Tony Duggan. Although we didn't really want to hurt anyone's feelings at the time, when we were doing Montenegro in the commentary, they were abysmal.
That's to put it nicely, I think, as well.
Sanderson with a little header back. England preparing another substitution. And it's a free kick. Sean Scott's going to come up.
Again, Jill Scott's had another fantastic season for Manchester City, so I'm really pleased that she's had this opportunity to come on and you know, play at Wembley in front of this crowd. And she's another energy player. She'll get up and down, pretty similar to Jordan Knox. I wouldn't be surprised if she comes on for her.
Well, she's awaiting. No chance. Jill Scott. She'll certainly be one of the tallest players out there. Her nickname at times has been Crouchy after... Peter Crouch, 5 goals for Manchester City. It'll be Arsenal to land the Continental Cup. She played against Germany in World Cup 2007, the 0-0 draw. Germany, I don't think, conceded a goal through the whole of that tournament. And we are looking for a fourth. Sasic and another hat-trick. Trying to find Mittag. Drew away confidently. Our bronze for England. Carney. Played in behind Crown. That's a much better ball for England. But the veteran defender read the situation and got it away. Stole it away from Tony Duggan. Germany are playing Mittag very high. And that's left a couple of gaps. That's going to be Farrah Williams who goes off for Jill Scott.
What do I know? I thought it was going to be Jordan Knobbs, just a similar type of player, but Jill can play in there, so she, whether they'll, I think she's going to come straight and pretty much just as it's a change for change. I think she'll just sit in as Farrah Williams did.
So she hit the cap for Jill Scott, Sunderland girl. Derby. Danny Stokes, Kirby's going to watch the offside there. Well played, Germany. Stokes has got to the dead ball line. The way Germany came out, England couldn't get the ball back out wide to Kirby because she was left in the offside position. Well, it's a really good unit then, Germany. Jill Scott, who came on there, one of the first to get a central FA contract. I mean, that's made a huge difference to England. Women's football. Sanderson tried to lay it off. Made away by Marazan. Germany on the counter. It's away to the right hand side. Can be slid in here. Dangerous. Just cut out for a corner kick. Really dangerous that, because Germany had pop in the middle.
Yeah, there's a couple of players in the box there. But that's what they do. They counter attack so quickly. They win the ball and then within a couple of seconds they're in their attacking third.
Jennifer Marazan with the corner kick for Germany. And the 20 minutes to go. And the goals in the first half. Good confident. Aggressive goalkeeping. And the punch away. And Danny Stokes. He needs to get there again. Big pitch. Heavy pitch, demanding pitch. Good cross though, Barsley under pressure, dealt with it well and she was crunched. I think the referee here should have a word. I think Alex Pop knows exactly what she's doing. I think that's dangerous play on a goalkeeper. She knew she was going to get nowhere near the ball. Absolutely clattered into Steph Horton and the goalkeeper.
Yeah, I completely agree, and the referee hasn't said a word because, like you say, Karen Bardsley had the ball in her hands and she knew that Alex Pop, that there was no chance of even challenging for it, but safe, good hands from Karen Bardsley. That's two things she's had to do in the space of about 5 minutes and has done it excellently well.
Been a better player recently from the bench for Germany, Alexandra Pop. She scored in her last 5 goals as a substitute. Started off brightly here. When she was playing slightly behind Sasic, England found it difficult to control her, but she's played almost up front as a two in the second half, and I think that's been easier, much easier for England to deal with.
Yeah, I don't think she's that sort of player. I don't think she likes to receive the ball. I think she likes to come a little bit deeper and get the ball and drive at players and make things happen from that position. So as an out-and-out centre-forward, it's not really her strength. I suppose it's good from an England perspective.
Germany have three goals, but if England get one, crowd will lift the roof off. We've extended today because of the wintry weather. 45,619 in the end. We'll look down on the expected figure. Now captured 55,000. But had there not been the engineering work, I think they'd have put at least 60,000, 70,000 in the ground. Run by Gersling. She'll be ready to play a part next summer.
Yeah, definitely. And you know, this is getting her match fitness, because really, yes, it's a massive occasion. We're playing at Wembley and it's England v Germany, but it's really a preparation game for the World Cup, and that's what Germany will be looking at. They'll be looking at her fitness, Gosling, to make sure that she is fit for the World Cup, and she's got that match fitness. I know it's a long time, but you want to start now, don't you?
Germany are adding another substitution. I think it's Pauline Bremer who's going to come on. Looks like her. Bensing. Bremer does come on. Could be loud area of the parts. Then, maybe after it, keeping in. I think Germany caught him out of goal, 3-0 down. Indeed. Pauline Bremer. Plays for the Turbine Potsdam team, lying fourth in the table at the moment. Scored 7 for them. She's come on now in all four of her international appearances from the bench. For a quarter of an hour against Sweden and came on for half the game against France, that 2-0 defeat earlier this season. Her debut, her 19th birthday earlier this calendar year. So whipped in the cross, took the deflection, well played. Josephine Henning, it's a corner kick to England.
Good pressure from Jill Scott initially. You can see she's actually, I got it wrong, Jordan Nobbs is actually, she's sitting where Farrah Williams was sitting, and Jill Scott's just gone into Jordan Nobbs' position. She pressurised so well to win the ball, and now they've got a corner, so they need to try and do something a little bit different to try and capitalise from this.
Derby with the corner kick, Borton forward, Sanderson trying to slip her marker. Play back for Carney, the hoisting in the box, looking for Jill Scott. Where it goes. Better, more thoughtful attacking there from England, though, from the set piece. Stokes. There are so many easy wins in qualifying. It's been a sobering afternoon in terms of the scoreline. The history of the women's game, just being here at Wembley, official international, so close. So many good things happening. 1,400 women's teams at the moment, 3,500 girls, and 2,000 of those in school competitions. 20% of the players from black or Asian or ethnic backgrounds. Something on the pitch as well. Jill Scott's gone wide. Jordan Knox plays her in. Can she get there? She had to stretch. Heading got across. In the end, the ball lacked that little bit of quality. Maybe the soggy pitch held it up.
It seemed to be, because you could see it was exactly the right option, because we were sort of pointing to give it to Jill Scott. You could see her. She was making that dynamic run. But it just held up and she just couldn't get onto the end of it to whip the ball in.
Carney. Karen Carney. Jodie Taylor's getting ready to come on for England. Forward who made a debut recently in qualifying. Scott to Sanderson. Back to Jill Scott. Done well since she came on. Looking for Duggan in the middle. Well handled. And it's shit. Took her 12th clean sheet in 17 games for her country.
I think Jodie Taylor is getting ready to come on, and she's another player, centre forward, who's got excellent movement. So she'll be the one, she'll be looking for that ball in behind. She can use her pace in there, and she's quite a positive, direct runner with the ball as well.
Kirby. Greenwood's going to be able to come on as well over there for England. She's got 10 minutes to go. Second after a shaky start. Half time. That's a lot of Jennifer Marishan. Since she came on. Here's Kramer. Relative newcomer, just her 15th cap. Played the one qualifier. So here comes Jodie Taylor. The Washington Spirit Club. Yeah, Sanderson goes off. Jodie's been all around the place, really. Oregon State, Boston, Ottawa, California, Melbourne, Gothenburg. That's her third cap.
I was going to say, don't forget Lincoln.
Oh, and Birmingham, I think, in there somewhere.
Yeah,
as well.
It was, yeah. I actually played at Lincoln with her. And Tranmere. I think that's where she originally started off.
Mittag. Not wide again, Mittag, and playing a more disciplined role. She had that wandering spell when she was up there with Sasic looking for goals, and they had a word.
Greenwood's definitely ready. She's got a kit on, and I think it might be Joe Clotter as well. I think it's just an opportunity, isn't it, to give these players a chance to see how they do.
Here's Kirby. Lemmy Stokes. It's Greenwood, would I imagine, come on for her. Joe Potter, good to see her back against Montenegro in the last qualifier. She scored. That was her first cap since 2007. 30s. Out to Bremer. Duggan, Kirby. Oh, dropped her shoulder beautifully. And then just wouldn't come.
Good play. You could see that just a little bit of flash of brilliance, couldn't you, from Frank Kirby there? Just dropped her shoulder and got that yard. For me, I think hit it. You know, she was too nice and went to pass it. Have a go.
Horton. Looking to set Taylor away. And the cross shot. Angle tightening all the while. Chance went.
That's what she's got. She's got excellent movement and she's got excellent pace, and she will do that all day. She will run in behind, and you can see it was sort of a cross-cut shot. There was nobody else in the box because they probably couldn't keep up with their pace.
So Potter, Alex Scott, and Demi Stokes heading off for Greenwood to come on. So comes Greenwood. FA Cup runner-up with Everton this season. Relegated, though, with them as well. She's been there since she was 8. She's now, what, 21? Forward in the last minute to score Montenegro in that last qualifier.
I am really pleased to see Jo Potter back into the squad and into actually playing, because she's played ever so well for Birmingham for the past few seasons for me, and she's got a cultured left foot, and she's somebody that can create things and make things happen. It's quite interesting that she's gone into centre-half. You know, usually you see Jo Potter as either a left midfielder or a centre midfielder, so be interested to see how she does there.
Attendance for England home international confirmed by the FA. Great reaction. Over 45,000 here. The quarter finalists, last couple of World Cups, and I would imagine, what, from the FIFA world ranking, they should reach the last eight again. They'll have to be very tough to break into that elite group. Japan, the current holders, they beat the USA 3-1 on penalties following a 2-2 draw in Frankfurt last time around. And look for Duggan, who backs out of the box. One of the scandals of the World Cup, though, is that FIFA plan to play matches on artificial turf. And they say it's helped the development of the game. Well, that's fair enough, that's an argument. So if in 3 years' time they turn around and say half the men's World Cup final matches are going to be played on 3G pitches, you watch the reaction there.
Of course, and I think, you know, it's quite interesting that the England girls have actually come out and just said, we don't care, we just want to go to the World Cup, we don't care what we play on. I know a lot of the teams, Liverpool and Everton, both play on 3G pitches week in, week out, so they will be used to it. But I think, you know, historically you want to play on grass pitch, don't you, in the World Cup.
Marashan. Minutes to go. Taylor. Bronze, right back now. Played there in the last qualifier. Played left back as well in the tournament. To go to Canada. We played in Montreal, Edmonton, Vancouver, Winnipeg, Ottawa, Moncton next summer. Got themselves in a bit of a pickle here. Alex Greenwood getting caught in possession. Mittag's gone away from her as well. She was lucky to get the block. Carney. And watching as Germany about to make another substitution. Substitutions. Really trying to get to pop away down the right hand side. Into Sasic. All time could be up. She's looked across at the dugout a couple of times. Mittag. Sasic said we get on a hat trick. Trying to play her in there as well. Out by Jill Scott. She's had another nervy look across to the dugout, which would suggest this is a planned move. There she's looking again. I'm going to send on Petra Babek, and Verena Feist is going to come on too. Feist is a centre back. Babek is a left back. Off goes Celia Sasic. For her today, an 8th hat trick. Come up for Petra, and Sasic off for Feist. Just to give them a run out, 2 minutes to go. Babette plays for the Wolfsburg club. She was part of the 2007 winning World Cup squad, though she didn't make an appearance in the final. She was on the bench. Closing stages of the game. 90 seconds ago, plus stoppage time. She's played well for England, Lucy Bronze.
Yeah, she really has. And I think we've got to say that these girls now are training full-time. So a lot of them are, you know, training every day. If not, they're training at least 3-4 times a week. And you can see the difference. It's the, you know, 88th minute, and yet these players are still running. You know, there's no cramp. And yes, we have had changes, but the fitness levels have improved so much. And we are creating chances against European champions, Germany.
It's the way Lucy Bronze went down there moments ago. May have forced the England management to think of a change. Laura Bassett's getting ready to come on. Defender. Pressure didn't quite pay off there. Germany play out to Bensing. Terrific, two centre-backs, Clark and Hinnie. England come through the middle, Tony Duggan. Steps away to the right-hand side, here's Jordan Knox. Turner away to the inside right channel. Bronze. She's okay there. Pounding forward. Typically aggressive run by Lucy Bronze. Taylor around the corner, Jill Scott. Chance for England! Side netting record.
Great play from Lucy Bronze down the right-hand side, and she plays there for Liverpool. She's used to that. She likes to get forward, and you can see what a nice just ball around the corner from Jodie Taylor. Jill Scott, perfect first touch. For me, she had to square it. You know, she went for glory. She could see the goal. If she could have squared it, there were two players in there ready to just tap the ball home.
Laura Bassett comes on for Lucy Bronze. Experienced player, 43 caps now. First Birmingham player to be capped by England. Chelsea. Birmingham to take them into the Champions League quarterfinals for the first time. He reached the semis in the end. Here's Duggan. Three in the middle to hit. Far post. Didn't quite come on. Away for a corner kick. Catch it with the defending. Into the 3 minutes of stoppage time, a couple of minutes left.
See, the crowd are just desperate for a goal, aren't they? Every time England go forward, it just raises an extra level.
Taylor waits in the middle, Alex Greenwood with the corner. Firm header away by Bensing. Greenwood again. With a lash cross, Horton have gone up. A run away from Anya Mittag, it's a throw to England. Just a goal would warm the hearts of the England fans. Jordan Knox. So much better second half for England in terms of organisation, tight defending, but it has to be said that Germany, I don't think, have got out of third gear in this second period. They might do here now, no they won't.
Yeah, definitely much better second half. First half, I think, like you say, maybe they didn't get close enough to them. The Germans were so clinical in front of goal, and that's probably where we lacked a little bit. But you've got to take the positives from the second half. We've created chances. We've got in behind the Germans. But again, it's the Germans, and we still haven't beaten them. And we need to try and overcome this psychological barrier that we seem to have.
Tufa Sasic and the own goal by Alex Scott. And she tried to get across and cover. And undone England. Have a late free kick. They have the captain playing up front now, Steph Horton. Mark Sanson, the young manager, worked for a while with Roberto Martinez at Swansea on his coaching staff. Decent spin by the substitute Marisan initially. Some build up here, pop out wide. That's offside, I would think. Yep. Swiss officials have been decent, but it's just, I think they might have brought out a yellow card for her. Number 18, Alexander Pop. Historic day, England's first official international at the new Wembley Stadium. Marred by two for Celia Sasic and the own goal by Alex Scott. Gives Germany a 3-0 win, but every one of the 46,000 crowd has played a part in a little slice of history. And England's women's football is on the way up despite this result. They're both off to the World Cup finals next summer. Germany will be the stronger side there, according to the bookies, and they've won here by 3-0.
Well, an historic occasion, but unfortunately not a historic result. Germany just too strong for Mark Sampson's England after a tough 45 minutes. At least there's a little bit of encouragement in the second half for England at Wembley Stadium, if not the goal. Well, we were hoping for a goal for England and a performance from England. We didn't get the goal, but did we get the performance, Katie?
No, I think it was a poor performance by England. I think we needed to go out there and give a goal. Other than the start, obviously hitting the crossbar, we haven't really created anything other than that. I think we put the pressure on, but haven't really got anything from the game. We needed to get a goal, I think.
We always knew what Germany could do, and Germany were very German today in terms of they have everything, don't they? But what could England have done better?
I think I said it in the half-time talk, the physicality, the strength, the domination. I think we need to put a bit more fight in the tackles. Our passing was a little bit sloppy, and I just think we need to take it to them a little bit more. We need to really get at it, but I thought we were a little bit kind of weak in a few challenges, and they're just so much stronger than us.
But does that come to the psychology once again? We're always talking about the psychology of England versus Germany. Is that what it is primarily?
The mentality of Germans is always they're going to go in a game and they're always going to win. I think we need that mentality. That we're going to win, not that we might win. So I think that mentality needs to change, especially going forward for a World Cup as well.
But how does it change? Is it sports psychologists? What can be done between now and Canada next summer?
That's what we've got working within the squad at the moment. We've got psychologists coming in. We're working on like the team togetherness, working on the mentality. And I think over the next few months, I think we've got 6-7 months to the World Cup, and hopefully we can really develop that and work forward for that for the World Cup.
Now, how important is it, Katie, that England continue to play against top nations between now and the World Cup, bearing in mind that the qualifying campaign, 10 wins out of 10, only one goal conceded, they simply weren't tested.
They weren't tested, and I think it shows today that they need to be playing these opposition, because these are who they're going to come up against in Canada in the World Cup. I think it's important that we take, obviously, positives and the negatives, and we work from this game, and hopefully we can play the bigger nations to improve us as a team.
OK, well, let's have a look at how Germany beat England. Good-o! Let's see the goals again.
Yeah, I think this first goal, obviously, it's unfortunate for Alex Scott to score an own goal, but I think it's just the defending, to lock onto those defenders and just try and get the momentum to really clear that ball away, but it's unfortunate for Alex.
Well, Celia Sasic, formerly Dunbarby, used to score a lot of goals, continues to score them. She helped herself to a couple, could well have had a hat-trick.
Yeah, she's a fantastic player and a very clinical finisher as well, and yeah, I think we'll be very disappointed defensively on this goal. Obviously, it's a bit of a mix-up between Farah and Steph here, and then she's in on goal. She's running all the way through, and I think Lucy Bronze is don't know whether to go with the forward or go to Sasic, and I think she makes the decision a little bit too late, and it's a great finish.
And Sasic then scored her 55th goal in 99 internationals, so she doesn't just score goals against England.
That's a record in itself. I mean, that just shows. And I think today they showed how clinical they were from the goals they scored.
Yeah, I think this goal, obviously, is a fantastic cross. And I think, like I said in the halftime analysis, someone needs to lock onto her. Someone needs to take charge and actually mark her. Because it's a fantastic header, no doubt about it. Great cross, but someone needs to mark her and someone needs to clear that ball away.
OK, well, Karen Carney won her 100th cap here at Wembley today. She's talking to Tina Dehealy.
Karen, mixed emotions for you today, winning your 100th cap, but not the result you wanted.
No, it wasn't the result we wanted, but we've got 6 months to get it right now ahead of the World Cup. I think if you'd have said to us, get it perfect now in 6 months, we'll take it in 6 months, but they're a top team. We've got a lot to learn from, and, you know, everything happens for a reason, so we'll learn from it and we'll be better.
What went wrong today?
Sometimes I think it was a little bit naive in the first half. We just got to get through the first 20 minutes, keep a clean sheet. But, you know, we've done our best and we'll be better next time and we'll learn from it. You know, it's our probably second major competitive game after Sweden and we've done really well against Sweden, but Germany are a different entity. So we've got to be better. We've learned and I think we've got to go away, have a rest and come back fitter, faster, stronger.
The second half was better. What did Mark say to you at half-time?
I just think we found our rhythm. You know, it was encouraging and positive. And we just found our rhythm and had a little bit more belief. We probably didn't realise we had that much time on the ball as we probably thought. And we'll go away and we will reflect and we'll get better for sure.
And on a positive note, how special was it to be playing here at Wembley in front of a record crowd on the night, on the afternoon that you won your 100th cap?
It's a credit to everyone involved in the FA and everyone that got this occasion for us. You know, we'll be better. Hopefully we'll back again and we'll get the right result. But, you know, fair play to the team and we finish on a high with the crowd and we'll be back and be better.
Well, congratulations.
So a proud day then for Karen Carney. Not the results you wanted, not the performance you wanted, but talking about the World Cup next summer, this is what it's all about. It's not just about the record crowds at Wembley. Let's talk about them playing the United States. Their coach, who's English, has confirmed that England will be playing them. Mm-hmm. Is that the sort of opposition England need to face now?
They do need to face opposition. It just shows today that we need to go up against them good teams and teams that we are going to face in these big tournaments, because in a tournament situation, it's tough anyway. And obviously going up against the big nations, it just proves that that's where we need to be and we need to start competing.
OK, well, let's hear from the England manager now, Mark Sampson, who's with Tina.
Mark, disappointing for England. How would you assess their performance?
Disappointing result, obviously. You know, we came into the game hoping we could win, and I think we learned some really valuable lessons today in terms of the clinicalness of the German finishing and the threat on the counter-attack. But I've got to applaud the spirit of the team. I thought to come in at half-time 3-0 down, conceding a goal right on the half-time interval, you know, the spirit and character they showed in the second half, they've got to be applauded for, and there's some really good signs for us moving forward, because we'll take lots of positives from that game in terms of the way we try to control possession. And obviously some defensive errors we made, we can correct them quite quickly. And we have to remember that we've got 6 months to be ready for this tournament. It's not starting in December, it's starting in June, and we'll learn some valuable lessons from today.
Talking of valuable lessons, we talked about the attacking lineup, very adventurous and forward-thinking. But of course, England were perhaps lacking a little bit of steel in midfield. Do you think perhaps Mark Sampson will reflect on that?
Yeah, I think the likes of kind of Farrah Williams, she's more of a holding midfielder. Then we've got kind of Kaz Kearney, Jordan Nobson, Tony Duggan. They're really kind of attacking players and they're not really kind of more defensive. So maybe we need to maybe look at that. I don't know. But we really did go for it. But it obviously didn't work out for us.
What do you think England could take from this, the positives? You're struggling.
Yeah, struggling. Then we hit the crossbar. No, I think there will be positives. I think looking back on it, they will get some positives to take from it.
OK, well, before we go, there's just time to remind you that all the weekend's Premier League action will be featured on Match of the Day 2 tonight from 10:30. That's a little bit later for our Scottish viewers when it's at 11:25. And BBC 3 at 7 o'clock will feature the conclusion of the Formula One season. Would Lewis Hamilton or Nico Rosberg be crowned champion? Tune in for the full story. Well, history has been made. England have played at the new Wembley in front of a record crowd. But some things just never, ever change. Goodbye.